Will you please stand for the reading of the Word of God? Turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, as we continue our prophetic sermon series titled, The Coming Fourth Reich, and this sermon, The Final Farewell. The most exciting event the world has ever seen in the past 2,000 years is about to happen. It's called the rapture of the redeemed Church of Jesus Christ. Are you ready? Are you ready? 1 Thessalonians 4:16, read with me. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. And they are comforting words. When you look at the madness of society in which we live, God has a better plan for the redeemed. We're going to live in a city where roses never fade, where tears have never fallen from the eye of a believer, from a city that has never heard the world goodbye or farewell, that has never known the spirit of fear, where we will walk on streets of gold and live in mansions designed by the architect of the ages. That's just about to happen in the twinkling of an eye. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus, let this Holy Spirit fill this place today, and let us see the King coming in all of his glory. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's children said, praise the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Let me give you the Bible basis for the rapture of the church. John 14, 2 and 3. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Say that with me. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. A second verse of scripture confirming the coming of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15:51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we, the living, shall be changed. Some tried to ignore the rapture of the church because they say the word rapture is not found in the biblical text. That's true. But the word Trinity is not found in the biblical text, and yet it is taught very plainly in Matthew 28, 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's a very clear word picture of the Trinity. The Trinity begins in Genesis, the first chapter. Let us make man in our image. And it continues to the end of the Revelation. The word homosexual is not found in the Bible either. Yet we believe it to be an abomination based upon the scripture that says in Leviticus 18, 22, quote, you shall not lie with a male as one lies with a female. It is an abomination, end of quote. I know that's not politically correct, but God Almighty really doesn't care what you think. I didn't write the Bible. But I teach the Bible, and I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the word of life to those who hear it. What I have just demonstrated to you is something that people do not think about. The Bible is a book of word pictures, so that any person of any level of education over the centuries of time when men did not have an education could hear these verses and get what the Bible was saying. How many of you understand what I just got through saying? What is the rapture? The rapture of the Church of Jesus Christ is the first phase of Christ's return. When the rapture happens, the trump of God shall sound. Jesus will descend from heaven. He will stay in the clouds. He's not coming to earth. He will be in the clouds, and he will bring with him the perfected spirits of believers who have died. At that same instant, he will resurrect their bodies, and their bodies shall join their spirits as they sail into heaven. This is what Paul means when he says, the mortal shall put on immortality. The dead in Christ will rise first. They are joining their spiritual body, coming with Christ. How does this happen? Christ is the victor over death, hell, and the grave. Listen, if one molecule of your body remains in the grave, he is not victor. This is his day of absolute victory over Satan and over his kingdom. He is the absolute victor over death, hell, and the grave. The victory belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Let me show you on this chart. We are now living in the church age. Let's say that it's 2016 this year, and you're driving home today, and suddenly you take off and you're gone in the twinkling of an eye. You've gone to the mansions on high that God has promised for those who are redeemed. In this rapture experience, the living are here. They are translated saints. But the dead in Christ who have been buried, this is the grave. The dead in Christ who have been buried go first, and their spirits are joined here, and we both walk through the gates of heaven together to go to the judgment seat of Christ. What is that? The judgment seat of Christ is not to determine if you get to heaven, you are in heaven. It's to determine what you did in your Christian life and how well you did it. We are going to answer for the gap that exists between what you could have done had you obeyed the Lord and what you did not do. Because you are going to give an account for every word, for every thought, and for every deed. That's another sermon for another day. Then the Antichrist is going to appear. He's going to rule the world for 7 years. And then there will be many, many people who will be killed there who will not take his mark. Then the tribulation saints are going to be taken into heaven to join the body of Christ so that they can be participants in the marriage supper of the Lamb. Down on this earth, when Satan is bound, he'll be thrown into hell. There will still be the wicked in the grave. There is going to be 1,000 years of perfect peace when the lion shall lay down with the lamb. Think about that. Isaiah said it will be such peace that if your child is playing in a cockatrice nest, a cockatrice is in Texas a rattlesnake, you have no fear of the child being injured. We're going to have that kind of peace. Men will study war no more. There will not be a battle of any kind for 1,000 years of perfect peace. At that point in time, those who have not received Christ, who have been lying in the grave 7 years and 1,000 years, 1,007 years later, are going to rise here in what the Bible calls the second resurrection. It is the great white throne judgment for the wicked, and only the wicked are there. And the Bible says there is weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Why? Because the only reason they are there is to be judged, to return, to come back, to live forever in the lake of fire, according to Revelation, the 20th chapter, verses 14 and 15. There's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth because they know their soul is lost because they did not receive Jesus Christ as the Son of God. That explains the resurrections that are recorded in the Bible. Now, when does this happen? Christ is the victor over death, hell, and the grave. If one molecule of your body remains in the grave, he is not victor. This is his day of absolute victory over Satan. Victory is ours through the Lord Jesus Christ. When the dead in Christ rise first and are rejoined with their spirits and sail into heaven, those who are alive and remain shall be caught up in the twinkling of an eye. What is the twinkling of an eye? Paul couldn't say in a nanosecond because people didn't know what a nanosecond was. The twinkling of an eye is not the batting of an eye, because the batting of an eye requires that the neurological impulse go to the brain and back to the muscle in the eye and you blink. Very, very quick, but that's not fast enough. The twinkling of an eye is when it goes straight to the brain and that's it. It's quicker than a blinking of an eye. Literally, biblically, it is the snatching away so instantaneously it is not perceptible by natural vision. That's quick. What is the rapture? The resurrection of the righteous and transformation of the living believers. Those who die without accepting Jesus Christ are going to remain in their graves another 1,007 years until they come to the judgment for the wicked. There will be a second resurrection. And it is the resurrection that John calls the resurrection of the damned. They will be brought to the great white throne judgment, weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth because they have rejected the Son of God and are now being formally sentenced. Why? Because it is appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Christians will be judged at the judgment seat of Christ. The wicked will be judged at the great white throne judgment. Listen, we are not ever going to appear together to be judged. It's important for you to understand that. Pastor Hagee, what's the difference? What difference does it make whether I believe in the rapture or not? Exactly this. Hebrews 9:28 says, to those who eagerly look for him, he will appear a second time. Hear that? To those who eagerly look for him, will he appear a second time? That means if you're not looking for him, you're not going with him. That's what that means. The Bible says, watch and pray. Say that with me. Watch and pray that you may be counted worthy to escape those things that are coming on the earth. The question is, if Jesus is coming back, why now? Remember that Israel is God's prophetic clock. The signs of his coming are all around us. Israel was reborn in 1948 after almost 2,000 years of wandering. Ezekiel 36:24 says, for I will take you from among the heathen Gentiles, and I will get you out of all of those countries and bring you into your own land, period. And miraculously, supernaturally, in May 1948, that happened. The greatest prophetic fulfillment of my lifetime. Every Bible prophet said that that would happen, and it did happen. Secondly, when Jerusalem is rejoined to Israel, in Luke 21:24, the Bible says, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Jerusalem is no longer trodden down by the Gentiles. They were liberated in the Six-Day War of 1967. Now get this in mind. Israel is God's prophetic clock. The year of Jubilee is 50 years. Jubilee starts on 49, but at the end of 49 years is 50 years. 50 years in 1967, when Jerusalem was rejoined to Israel, is 2017. Israel's 100th birthday from the Balfour Amendment that was given in 1917 is 2017. You have a lot of indicators in the Bible saying 2017 is going to be an exciting year on this earth. Get ready, get ready, get ready. A And then how can we know that we're close? Because of those four blood moons. Joel 2:30, 31, "And I shall show wonders in the heavens. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord." Jesus said in 21:25, "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon. The power of heaven shall be shaken." God Almighty is shouting from heaven, "The King is coming. The King is coming." When you see these signs, lift up your heads and rejoice. Your redemption draweth nigh. You're getting ready for the final farewell to planet Earth. Goodbye, world. Goodbye. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Will there be a rapture? 1 Thessalonians 4:16, "For the Lord himself shall descend with a shout." Why shout? Because this is the day of absolute victory. This is his day of absolute victory over death, hell, and the grave, when every molecule of the righteous is redeemed and taken to heaven. And that's why he's shouting. With the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. The trump in the Bible is used to announce the appearance of royalty. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the one who was and is and always shall be. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up with those in the clouds of glory, and so shall we meet the Lord in the air. Wow! The doubters, the skeptics, the agnostics, the atheists, the secular progressive shout, "That's never happened before." Wrong, wrong, wrong. There are six certified accounts of raptures occurring in the scripture. Let me give them to you. The first is the rapture of Enoch in Genesis 5:24, confirmed by Hebrews 11:5. Genesis 5:24 says, "And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him, snatched him off of the earth." The second rapture is the rapture of Elijah, 2 Kings 2. "And it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heavens by a whirlwind, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire. And Elijah went up in the whirlwind into heaven." Elijah has been in heaven over 3,000 years, and he's never died. Why is that important? Because the Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. He's been up there breathing oxygen or whatever you breathe in your mortal body. Things like that bother me. How does he get where? Where was the transformation here? 10,000 feet, there's no oxygen. How's he doing it? I'm sure God didn't put that in the Bible, but I'm going to ask him when I get to heaven. Elijah is going to come back to earth during the tribulation period. He's going to be sent by God because the last person God told the Jewish people to look for in the book of Malachi is Elijah. "I'm going to send to you Elijah the prophet." And Elijah is going to tell them that the Messiah is coming. Get ready. And after 3.5 years, he will be giving this message. He is going to be killed on the streets of Jerusalem. And he will be watched over national television. And the Bible says that he will, at the end of the third day, rise. And all the eyes of the world shall see him. And people are going to be terrified. Why? Because they've taken the mark of the beast, which is a loyalty oath to the son of Satan, the Antichrist. And the resurrection of Elijah on global television is going to confirm that Jesus Christ is Lord, that only he has all power in heaven, that in earth. And he is really still the boss. And they have made a colossal mistake. And they tremble with fear because the Lord of hosts rules and reigns with power and great glory. Give him praise in the house. The third rapture is the rapture of Isaiah, Isaiah 6:1-3. Isaiah 6:1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne, and his train filled the temple. The angels placed a live coal on Isaiah's lips." For my eyes have seen the King. This was not a vision. He was in heaven. The fourth rapture was that of Jesus in Acts 1, 9, 11. And when he, Jesus, had spoken these things, he was taken up in a cloud and received him out of the sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men standing by them in white apparel. They were angels. Ye men of Galilee, why stand you here gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, say that with me, this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come again in like manner as you have seen him go. The King is coming. The King is coming. The King is coming. The rapture of Philip, Acts 8. Philip vanished into thin air. He did not go to heaven, but he was bodily transported, not to heaven, but from one geographical location to another that was 20 miles away. There was an Ethiopian that was reading the scripture. It was imperative that this Ethiopian understand what the scripture was about, because he was critical to getting the gospel message to his nation. And God had an evangelist, Philip, 20 miles down the road. There was no high-speed taxi, so God just reached over, snatched him, and put him right down by the chariot. And he said, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And the Ethiopian said, "No." He explained it, and the gospel explosion happened that carried the gospel to the African nations. How quickly can we travel in our glorified bodies? Let me explain again Daniel 9, 3 through 23. Daniel was praying a prayer, and it has been timed by Hebrew scholars. It couldn't have taken him longer than 3 minutes to pray that prayer. And at the end of the prayer, when he finishes, Gabriel is there. And Gabriel says, "We heard you praying in heaven, and I have come to bring you the answer." It means that Gabriel came from heaven in less than 3 minutes. Gabriel may have been standing on one foot waiting for him to get through. Why? Because the Bible says God can answer even before you call. But let's just stay with the 3 minutes. If heaven is beyond the North Star, and it takes almost 200 years for light from the North Star to reach the earth, traveling 186,000 miles per second, think about that. And the angel got there in less time than that. That's so fast you can't imagine how fast it is. From heaven to earth, whew, like that. The rapture of St. Paul in 2 Corinthians 12. "And I know a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell, how he was caught up into paradise," heaven. Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "This day you will be with me in paradise," that was heaven, "and heard unspeakable words which is not lawful for a man to utter." Please understand that the first six raptures have already occurred, and the seventh rapture of the church is the only rapture that is still to come. The imminent return of Jesus Christ to this earth is right now, not in the future. The mystery of the rapture is in 1 Corinthians 51, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment." The word mystery in the New Testament is a truth that has never been revealed until this time. It's a divine revelation. And Paul was given that revelation because the New Testament church fully expected Jesus to show up any day. They expected him to establish the kingdom. But some of them started dying, and they started asking the church leaders, "What is going to happen to those who die in Christ?" Paul said, "Behold, I show you a mystery. I'm going to tell you something God has never told anyone before. It's revealed to you that you may know the future. Jesus said, when you see these signs, when you see nations against nation, when you see the nation of Israel reborn, when you see Jerusalem no longer trodden down by the Gentiles, when you see the moral collapse of America, when you see truth becoming a lie and the lie becoming the truth, when you see a prophet called a liar and a liar being called a prophet, when you see nation go against nation, when you see Russia come out of the north part, as Ezekiel said in the 38th chapter, and join hands with Iran, and they are loading up to go against Israel. When you see these things, when you hear people talk about the rebirth of the Roman Empire, the time for my coming is there. Look up. Your redemption, your rapture is nigh at hand. Give him praise in the house of God. You put these Bible verses together and you have this picture. The trump of God shall sound, announcing the appearance of royalty. The voice of the archangel shall summon the righteous from their graves, and all over the earth, the graves are going to explode as the occupants soar into the heavens to be united with their spiritual bodies for the meeting in the air. Coming instantly behind them will be those who are alive, instantly transformed by the supernatural power of the living God. Now get this picture. It happens. Maybe today while you're driving home, it happens. And cars are going to be empty beside the freeways, highways, and the motors are going to be running, and the occupants are going to be gone. Strangely missing, having left this veil of tears for mansions on high in the twinkling of an eye. Homes of believers will have the dinner dishes on the table. The food is on the stove. But the occupants are gone to the marriage supper of the Lamb, snatched away from this madhouse called planet Earth to the paradise that God has created for those that love him. Headlines are going to be screaming tomorrow. Millions are missing. Christians have disappeared from the earth. In a few short days, there will be a global economic crash because the Christians have gone and no one else is going to work. TV cameras will go into the cemeteries around the world and across the city and show ruptured mausoleums and empty Christian schools and empty hospital beds and empty homes gone to paradise where there is no more tears and no more suffering and no more pain and no more farewells, for the former things have passed away forever. Television networks will do their usual news-breaking telecasts. Where bespeckled commentaries gather around a table and explain what has happened when they don't have a clue what has happened. Some of you have cell phones trying to find some of your relatives. AT&T doesn't reach that far. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Churches are going to be packed with weeping, sobbing, hysterical people. The Lord has come, and we are left behind to go through the hell on earth of the great tribulation. You're either going to take the mark of the beast and lose your soul, or have your head cut off. And that's your choice. When you walk into the tribulation because you rejected Jesus. Some of you watching this telecast are going to be in line to take the mark of the beast, because what you think I'm saying is pure poppycock. You're living a godless life, and Jesus Christ is the last person you want to think about or talk to. But I assure you, he is the answer to every need in your life. He is the person you are looking for. God Almighty is not in heaven saying, let's make a deal. He's saying, this is the deal. I am the Lord and there is none other. I am the judge of all the earth. I am the blessed hope. I am the King of the universe. I am he that was and is and forevermore shall be. Maranatha, I am coming soon. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. When we stand in the gates of heaven, the bride of Christ will be coming from the north, the south, the east, and the west. John the Revelator says 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. That's the Bible way of saying unlimited millions will be coming. God himself is going to wipe away every tear from every eye. The gates are going to open wide. Jesus, the Son of God, is just inside. The thunder of his joy is going to explode and make the heavens shake. You think you've heard racket at the Super Bowl? I want to tell you that's a backyard discussion compared to what's going to happen when all of God's children get to heaven and we start singing and shouting the praises of God. The battle is over. The race has been won. The victory is ours. Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. It's homecoming time. Homecoming time. This church has about 270 funerals a year. There are thousands of people who used to attend this church who are now watching from the balconies of heaven, and they see us running the race. Paul said it this way, we are compassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses. That's who they are. My parents are there. My grandparents are there. Aunts and uncles are looking over the ramparts of heaven right now. Thousands of our precious church members are there. Your mothers are there. Your fathers are there. Your children, your husbands, your wives are wearing crowns of glory and dazzling white robes of righteousness, waiting just inside the eastern gate. They see us now from the balconies of heaven, and I hear them from the ramparts of heaven shouting, run, run, run the race. It's almost over. Fight the good fight. Endure the hardness. It will be worth it all when you get here. Run to gain the crown of life. Heaven is all and more you ever dreamed it could be. Give the Lord praise in the house of God. Those who attack the rapture teaching are saying, it's not literal, it's allegorical. Allegorical is a word that means it's a myth. Everything people don't want to believe who are in a self-serving kind of theology, call it allegorical. It's a myth. Let me tell you, this is a literal book. It is not an allegorical book. If it's a myth, I'm myth-taken, myth-defied, and of all men, most miserable. This book is literal from cover to cover. God Almighty literally created the heavens and the earth. Moses and the children of Israel literally walked across the Red Sea on dry ground. God literally destroyed the earth in a massive flood to keep Satan from taking over the planet. God literally empowered David to kill Goliath. Jesus was literally born of the Virgin Mary. He was literally born in the city of Bethlehem. He was literally the healer. He literally taught the word of God. He literally cast out demons. He literally turned water into wine. He literally commanded the winds and waves on the Sea of Galilee. He literally died on the cross. He literally is coming again in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He will rule the world with a rod of iron, and from his mouth shall go the word from the city of Jerusalem. He had the first word. He will have the last word. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the one who was and is and forevermore shall be. Give him praise in the house of God. The critics say, you people who are teaching the rapture are teaching nothing but escapism. You're trying to escape from the real world. The fact is, the rapture is no more escapism from the world than salvation is escapism from eternal hell. I gladly tell you that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Heaven is my home. I'm satisfied out of my ever-loving mind that I am not going to an eternal hell and that I am not going to go through the tribulation. If that's escapism, hallelujah, bring it on. Rapture is no more escapism than divine healing is escapism from sickness and disease. Environmentalists want to escape pollution. The peace movement wants to escape the war. Bible teaches us to prepare for escape. 1 Thessalonians 1:9 through 10 speaks of escaping the wrath of God in the coming great tribulation. Listen to this verse. You turn to God from idols to serve a living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, which is Jesus. Listen, who rescues us from the wrath that is to come. Who rescues us from the wrath that is to come. And it's speaking about the tribulation. A second verse for those of you who are just insisting we're going through the tribulation. You must enjoy suffering, but listen to this. 1 Thessalonians 5:9, for God has not destined us for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. The problem with the English language, that salvation is too broad a tent. That word in the Greek is soteria, and it means to be rescued physically. So read it that way. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to be rescued physically through the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what it means. Give the Lord praise in the house. In closing, what are we going to escape? The great tribulation. Walk with me quickly through just two chapters of the book of Revelation. One-third of all the vegetation in the earth is going to be burned up. All grass, all trees, from the intense heat of the sun. The sun and the moon are going to be darkened as there's a revolt against nature. It's going to be darkened for weeks on end, and people will fall into deep depression across the earth. Thirdly, the gates of hell are going to be opened, and the hordes of locusts the size of a horse upon the earth shall sting men like a scorpion, and the sting will last for a period of 5 months. Men will beg God to let them die, and God says no. There will be a worldwide famine. You can see it right now beginning to develop. A world will be so bloody that the blood of those who are killed in battle will flow for 200 miles up to the bridle of a horse in the valley of Jezreel in Israel. Every person on earth is going to be covered with running, festering boils like Job. The seven seas of earth will turn to blood. Every river, every creek, just as when Egypt was cursed of God, will produce blood. No oxygen will be in the water. The fish will die, producing famine, producing a maddening thirst and a stench that will cover the earth. The sun will scorch the earth and men with fire in a heat situation unlike the world could ever imagine. Global warming is going to happen. It's really going to happen. Major uncontrollable fires are going to break out all over the world spontaneously, destroying homes, vegetation, national economy, livestock. You think those fires in California are something? They are a Boy Scout campfire compared to what's going to happen here. Earthquakes are so shattering that the islands of the sea are going to disappear. That will be places like Puerto Rico and Hawaii. Every wall shall fall down flat. Hear that. Every wall on planet Earth, millions of people are going to be trapped beneath the rubble, and no one can come to their aid because the freeways are torn up. The highways, there's no transportation. Gas lines are going to be ruptured, producing fires, major fires in every city simultaneously. Revelation 9:15, four angels are released by God to destroy one-third of mankind in one day. Now I ask you, being of sound mind and having two brain cells that work, don't you want to miss that? I do. I really do. And I'm going to miss it. King Jesus is going to sound the trumpet in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. It's going to be a literal meeting in the air. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Lord of glory, the light of the world, is coming to redeem us. He is the lover of my soul, the son of King David. He is the day star, the bright and the morning star, the fairest of 10,000, the rose of Sharon, and the lily of the valley is on his way. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the one who was and is and evermore shall be. He is the bread of life at the marriage supper of the Lamb. He is the fountain of living water. He is the rock of my salvation. He is my shield and my buckler, my fortress and my high tower. He is the cornerstone, precious and elect in Zion. Upon this rock have I built my church, he said, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. He is Emmanuel, God with us, the hope of glory. He is the friend that sticketh closer than a brother. He is the fountain filled with blood. He is heaven's hope and hell's dread. He is crowned with many crowns because he is the King of all kings, and he is the Lord of all lords. Give him highest praise in the house of God. Stand. There are two groups of people watching this telecast, and two groups of people that are in this service. Those who have received Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, and those who have not. You have just heard me briefly describe two chapters in the book of Revelation. There are 7 years of constant suffering that is so beyond belief that when God pulled back the drape of the book of Revelation and the church was standing in heaven and they saw it, there was total silence for 30 minutes because they couldn't grasp the horror of what's happening. You can escape that with one single prayer in receiving the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're in this room and you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, you've never prayed the sinner's prayer, I'd like for you to slip your hand up because I want to pray it with you now. Would you hold your hand up now? God bless you, and God bless you. Hold it up high. God knows you. Thank you. God bless you, and God bless you. God bless you, sir. God bless you. Those of you that are watching by television, you can join us in this prayer. There's no distance in prayer. God can hear you right where you are. Pray this prayer right now. Heavenly Father,
in the name of the Lord Jesus,
I ask you to forgive me of all of my sin.
I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins.
Cleanse me from all unrighteousness.
Cleanse me from all unrighteousness.
And today, may the blood of Jesus, be applied.
Be applied
to my record in heaven.
To my record in heaven.
Father God,
from this day forward,
I will serve you.
I will serve
with my heart, soul, mind, and body.
With my heart, soul, mind,
I will read your word.
I will read your word.
And I will obey your word.
And I will obey your word.
From this day, I am a Christian.
I am a Christian.
Born again. By the blood of Jesus Christ.
By the blood of Jesus Christ.
And the Holy Spirit. I have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord praise in the house. Lift your hand for the blessing. And now may the Lord bless you. And may the Lord keep you. And may the Lord make his face to shine upon you. And may the Lord be gracious unto you and give you his peace. May you walk from this place today with the perfect confidence that you are God's child, that your past has been forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ, and that your tomorrows are completely protected by the hand of God. Because of your prayer and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And when the trump of God shall sound, we're going to meet the King in all of his glory in the clouds of heaven. And so shall we ever be with the Lord Jesus, with God the Father, with all of the saints and all of our families, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, receive that blessing. And all of God's children said, praise the Lord. Give the Lord a shout of victory in the house of God. We'll see you tonight. Amen.